Thank you for watching this video designed to help you understand the two different ways that Connecticut reports academic growth in English language arts and mathematics using smarter balanced results. This presentation is designed for individuals who have a good working knowledge of Connecticut's smarter balanced growth model. If you need an introduction to the growth model, click on the link in the description box below before proceeding. The growth model provides two main statistics. The growth rate, which is the percentage of students who met their growth targets, and the average percentage of target achieved, which is the percentage of the growth target that was achieved by all students on average. Let's look at the growth results for a Connecticut district to better understand these two metrics. Let's start with the growth rate. This is the percentage of students who met or exceeded their respective growth targets. In this example, of the 1,223 matched students in ELA, 46.7%, or 571 students, met or exceeded their growth targets. Conversely, the remaining 53.3%, or 652 students, did not meet their individual growth targets. They may have made some growth on the vertical scale, but they did not grow as much as their target required. In math, of the 1,220 matched students, 54.3%, or 663 students, met or exceeded their growth targets, while 45.7%, or 557 students, did not meet their individual targets. If that's the growth rate, then what is the average percentage of target achieved? To be clear, it is not a percentage of students. It's actually a percentage of the target. All students achieve a certain percentage of their respective targets. Some achieve 100% of their target, some 60%, some 50%, some 0%, and so on. When you average those percentages, you get the average percentage of target achieved. In other words, this is the average of the extent of their growth targets that's achieved by all students. In this example, the 1,223 match students in ELA, on average, achieved 64% of their respective growth targets. Let me say it again, the 1,223 match students, on average, achieved 64% of their respective growth targets. Correspondingly, in mathematics, the 1,220 match students on average achieved 72.7% of their respective growth targets. To summarize, in this district, more students are meeting their targets in math than in ELA. More than half of the students, 54.3%, are meeting their math growth targets. But in ELA, it's less than half of the students. 46.7% of students are meeting their ELA growth targets. Similarly, on average, students are achieving a greater percentage of their growth targets in mathematics as compared to ELA. To recap, the growth rate is the percentage of students who met their growth targets. The average percentage of target achieved is a percentage of the target that was achieved by the students on average. It's not a percentage of students. The average percentage of target achieved and the growth rate are obviously closely related. As students grow on the vertical scale, they'll achieve a greater percentage of their respective targets, and more students will meet or exceed their growth targets. Here's a visual illustration of the relationship between the two metrics. In this chart, each blue dot represents a Connecticut school. Each school is plotted on the chart based on its growth rate on the x-axis and its average percentage of target achieved in ELA for all students during 2016-17 on the y-axis. The red dot represents the state overall. The illustration shows that the two metrics are closely related and that, in general, schools with higher growth rates have a higher average percentage of target achieved. And here's the corresponding chart for mathematics growth. Though the two metrics are highly correlated, there is some variation. For example, two schools with a similar growth rate, shown here in yellow, have different average percentages of target achieved. This indicates that in the school with the higher average percentage of target achieved, students not meeting their targets are, on average, substantively closer to their growth targets. One other point. When the average percentage of target achieved is 100%, the percentage of students meeting their growth targets, remember this is the growth rate, may be slightly less than 100%. This happens because when calculating the average percentage of target achieved, the model gives credit for the growth of an individual student up to 110% of their target, while setting the floor at 0%. Now that you know what the two statistics mean, what is a good growth expectation? Of course, ideally, we want all students to achieve their growth targets. In the Next Generation Accountability System, the bottom line growth expectation is that the average percentage of target achieved will be 100%. If this is achieved, it would mean that the students are, on average, achieving 100% of their respective growth targets. We hope that this video has given you the requisite language to communicate the growth results. Remember, don't be satisfied with anything less than an average percentage of target achieved of 100%. An average in the 60 to 70% range is simply not enough. At 60 to 70%, it means that students are, on average, only achieving around two-thirds of their growth targets. That type of growth will not get the majority of students to higher levels of performance in future years. While some schools are nearing the expectation of 100%, the vast majority of schools in the state as a whole have a lot of work ahead of us. There are no shortcuts to improving academic growth. VERNON Public Schools' Blueprint for Success provides a nice model for an integrated approach that highlights five improvement drivers. They are rigorous curriculum that is implemented with fidelity and integrity, talent management that's designed to build and nurture staff capacity, family engagement that engages parents as partners in learning, professional learning that builds coherence and capacity, and student interventions to bring research-based tiered interventions and supports to students based on their needs. Thank you for investing the time necessary to understand the different ways that Connecticut reports academic growth.